So, thank you very much. And thank you, Maxime, for existing. So, important words. I was the thesis supervisor of Maxime. I was just in Moscow a couple of weeks ago and met a certain person to whom I mentioned. She mentioned Konsievich, and I said, yes, I know him. In fact, I was his thesis supervisor. Ha ha, she was telling everyone, this guy thinks he was the advisor of Maxime Konsievich. So it's true that, for instance, we have another man in the front row who much more reasonably considers that he was the advisor, but he wasn't. He was only the teacher. He only taught Maxime mathematics. But Maxime's PhD was not obtained in Moscow, but in Bonn, and I was his thesis advisor. And I even suggested the problem, not that I understood it, even the problem, let alone the answer, but this was in 1991 when Maxime had just arrived fairly, I think 1991. He had arrived fairly recently in Bonn. I had met him before in Moscow in 87, so he was already a lot older than when you first knew him, but he was still extremely young. And of course, I was completely overwhelmed. And we'd, if my memory is right, we invited you to Bonn once before, and then you came later as the second visit, the second time not as a visitor. And Professor Hirzbruch said to him, you know, if you don't have a PhD, we can only pay you like a student. So you need a PhD. He didn't have, I mean, not the doctor, he didn't have even the Kandidat, he didn't have a PhD. So he needed a PhD, and so he needed a supervisor, so I was assigned. And then the Arbeitstagung happened, and Atiyah gave the, as always, the opening talk.
It was 90.
Yeah, I wasn't sure which year. And so Atiyah gave, as always, the opening talk, and he explained Witten's conjecture. And at the end, I brought, you know, it's a long row, I brought Maxime down to introduce to Atiyah, who had been my first thesis supervisor, said, Michael, I would like to introduce you to my student, Maxime, who will probably be, I imagine, will be able to prove the conjecture you just told us. And so Atiyah looked at me like he's completely mad. You know, you come with this kid and tell him that he's this guy can probably, you know, prove the conjecture, you know, Witten, Atiyah. I mean, we're not talking high school mathematics here. And so he looked at me like, you know, I've known you a long time, Todd, but now you've really gone over the bend. And then I think 2 days later, there's the famous boat trip on the Rhine, part of the Arbeitstagung, and the entire, my memory at least, the entire 3 hours going and the entire hour and a half coming back, because, you know, it's downhill. It goes much faster. Atiyah and Maxime were together discussing, and Maxime showed the proof. Well, it wasn't complete. I think it was not completely finished till the end of the week, but the idea of the proof, 2 days after hearing of the conjecture, he had solved it, essentially, and of course, it was considered sufficient in Bonn for a PhD, and it was considered sufficient by the IMU for a Fields Medal, and so, strangely enough,
25 pages,
yeah. It's a long thesis, yeah, I mean, but it was, yeah, 25 pages. He hadn't yet read Как написать математическую статью по-английски, so he didn't know how to make it shorter. Now he would write it in 3 pages and nobody would understand. So I've been very disappointed since then. Sorry?
Qualifying exam.
Oh, that's another good... If I start telling about the qualifying exam, I'll never give my talk. But so I'll just say that I've been very disappointed. I haven't had a single student since who was that good. And it's not going to happen. Okay, so he's also a wonderful friend and a wonderful person, and I'm not going to say anything more, but the thoughts are there. So I'm supposed to give a talk, which means I have to take, roll up my sleeves. So the title of my talk had 3 ingredients. One of them I understand more or less, which is partitions, and one is quasi-modular forms, which I understand very well. And one is Ziegel-Veitch constants, which I don't really understand at all. But since that's the part that led to this work, the only part that's specifically connected with something Maxime has done, I decided I have to include it. But luckily, we had a beautiful explanation yesterday by Anton Zoric, who's still there. And so I can skip trying to explain things that I only half understand. So since that was explained, I won't say anything, but I want to say something first about the first two ingredients and then how it all comes together. So the last part, this is essentially going to be about, well, first of all, some old work, but in particular something I did many years ago with Masanobu Kaneko, and then a wonderful generalization, which my main point is to popularize, because maybe some of you don't know it, and also it's a beautiful theorem of Bloch and Okunkov of a few years ago, and I found a very, very simple proof, so I'll be able to essentially give you a complete proof of their theorem. And this part is joint work, well, with Dabei Chen and Martin Müller, except that I actually haven't, I'm not even sure I've ever met Chen. The joint work is Chen, Müller, and Müller and me. There's a part on Siegel-Veitch and a part on modern reforms, and you need them both, but they're disjoint, and the common link is Müller. And just for people who were at the talk yesterday and saw the very unusual spelling of Müller, this is the standard one. The one that we saw on the slide yesterday is based, I think, on the French champagne, Moët et Chandon, but it's just, it's too much. Okay. So I want to start with partitions because they're certainly the easiest. Oops, this thing doesn't go up as high as one expects. So a partition is a partition of a number, and the notation will be lambda is in n, and I'll use p, the script p, for the set of all partitions. So I won't specify the n. I mean, you could put pn. And the usual way of writing a partition would be lambda 1, lambda 2. And you can either stop at the last positive one, or you can just take a sequence of integers decreasing to 0 and only finitely many. And then to say that it's a partition of n means that the sum of the lambda I is n. So that's what a partition is. And of course, when you do what I'm always saying, but people always laugh that I always say this, but the only person who really lives by this precept, apart from me, is Maxime. Whenever you see numbers in life, a sequence of numbers, and it happens, then you should always make the generating function and take it seriously, and it almost always helps you. Sometimes it doesn't. So here, if you take P of n to be the number of partitions of a given number n, then of course what you should do is make the partition function, the generating function, n from 0 to infinity, p of n q to the n. And so this was noticed already very long ago by Euler, that this is equal to, well, I'll have a notation that I'll use. Sometimes it's convenient just so I don't have to write so much. The infinite product, 1 minus q times 1 minus q squared, and so on, which is called the infinite Q Pochhammer symbol. Sometimes this is just for convenience that I write that. And Euler, it's very trivial, of course, to prove that. Now, Euler noticed this fact. But Euler was then interested in computing the partitions, let's say up to 50. And so to do that, he said, well, if I can compute the generating function of the reciprocal, so Q infinity itself, this product, then that should be easier, and then I can always invert a power series. And so he found, well, this famous result, that this is the sum where every coefficient of q to the n is 0, most of them are 0, and otherwise plus or minus 1. So this is the sum minus 1 to the n, q to the 3n squared plus n over 2. And then if you know from high school that when you see a quadratic function, you should complete it to a square, to a perfect square, then you immediately see that actually the natural function is the product of this thing with q to the 1/24, because then you've completed the square, so it now becomes 6n plus 1 squared. About multiple forms, you know that if you have q to a perfect square and you sum over a lattice, maybe with some congruence conditions like n is congruent to either 1 or 7 modulo 12, and you take the alternating sign, this thing is a multiple form. And of course, it has a name. It's called eta. And so this is a multiple form, in this case, of weight a half, and it's the Dedekind eta function. And again, I assume that people do know what a multiple form is, although I'll very briefly remind you. So you take a variable tau, which should now be in the upper half plane. This is meant to be a German H, so the upper half plane is the complex numbers with positive imaginary part, and then one always writes, so this I won't repeat, Q is e to the 2 pi tau, and therefore if tau is in the upper half plane, Q is in the open unit disk. And then to say that it's a modular form in general means that if you take any matrix A, B, C, D, and S, L, 2, Z, then, well, here there's a 24th root of unity, so there's a little factor. But you have CD plus D to a certain power called the weight, which here is a half times 8 of tau. And this is what Dedekind discovered. So in other words, if we start with partitions, we immediately see that we're led to at least classical modular forms, which have this transformation law. So now let me introduce the second ingredient of my title before putting them together at all. So that's quasi-modular forms. Maybe I'll go here. So modular forms, if I take M star of SL2Z, so all modular forms on SL2Z, I won't write the group each time, so M star, then it's very well known that there are Eisenstein series, E4, E6, E8, and so on, which are modular forms of that weight. And it's very convenient to introduce shorthand notations due to Ramanujan. Actually, there's also an E2, but it's not a modular form, so it's not in this ring. So we have Eisenstein series P, Q, and R. I won't define the general one, but I can define these three since it's so easy. P is 1 minus the sum from 1 to infinity, n times q to the n over 1 minus q to the n. The q is 1 plus 240 times the same sum with n cubed. This is the same. And r is 1 minus 504 times the same sum with n5. And then the remarkable thing is that these functions, Q and R, are modular forms of weight 4 and 6, so they transform exactly like this. Now there's no funny factor, just with C tau plus D to the 4 and C tau plus D to the 6th. And of course, it's very well known that you have this relation and the eta that I had before. There are two relations with eta, and this, one of which is that the 24th power of eta is Q cubed minus R squared, well, divided by 1728, and also that the derivative of eta divided by eta, so the derivative is just the derivative, but it's very convenient to divide by 2 pi I so that we don't keep getting formulas full of 2 pi I's. I want to work over Q. And so this, in terms of the Q expansion, is just Q d by dQ. And then you see very easily that the derivative d eta by eta is exactly 1/24 times E2, which I'm calling P. So you already have a connection between what I told you here, which is that this Dedekind eta function, which is a modular form, is related to the modular forms Q and R. But there's a bigger ring called quasi-modular forms. The word was introduced, in fact, in this paper of Kaneko and myself that I mentioned about 10 years ago. Quasi-modular forms, you can define it for any group of Qs. I won't bother with, but the answer here is it happens to be a free algebra on three generators, which are exactly this P, Q, and R. So since that's not my main object today, let's just take this as a definition. It's certainly
included because you changed
complex
the number
an original ring.
Thank you. I won't work over Q all the time, just to keep life simple. Thank you. So now you have something very nice. We just had this derivative, and you see that the derivative of eta over, well, 8 isn't in this ring, but 8 to the 24th is, and that would just multiply this logarithmic derivative by 24. So you see that the logarithm, the derivative d of 8 to the 24th is in this ring, but in fact, d acts on this ring, and let me tell you, so there are the famous formulas, very easy to prove, that Ramanujan found, and just for completeness, I'll write them on the board. So the derivative of P is P squared minus Q over 12. The derivative of Q is PQ minus R over 3. And the derivative of R is PR minus Q squared over 2. So since it's a derivation, it's enough to do the generators. So it acts on the ring. And the last comment I want to make in this generality about quasi-modular forms is that we have three operators. So D sends F to, as I said, Q D by DQ of F. And this will be in MK plus 2. If, let's say that I have an F in MK tilde, so a quasi-modular form of weight K, the derivative will be a quasi-modular form of weight k plus 2. Then I have the weight operator, which is the Hamiltonian, if you prefer. It just multiplies a form by its weight. So of course, it doesn't change the weight. But I have a third operator. This is meant to be a German D, for those of you who like the Zutalin script. And this is, well, it's the derivative, 12 times the derivative with respect to E2 of F. So this will be a quasi-modeled form of weight k minus 2. And the derivative means if you, in this definition, there's no problem. Since I haven't defined F in an intrinsic way as a function of tau, you can do it by transformation property, but simply as a polynomial in modular forms, in a polynomial in P with coefficients that are modular. If you do that, you're just differentiated. So d by dp, the notation I've been using. So the reason I want these three operators, well, they'll come later. So trivially, the commutator of W and D is 2D, because W is the weight and D raises the weight by 2. And for the same reason, the commutator with D is minus 2D. And then finally, the commutator of D and D is W. And so this is an SL2, which is acting on quasi-modular form. So that's kind of, and the primitive part, the kernel of German D is exactly the modular form. So that's how to see modular forms in quasi-modular. So we'll see explicit examples in a minute. So now I want to say what this has to do, well, how these things first came together, at least for me. So the notion of quasi-modular form, it came from the physicists, well, several also Rudd, but the main person was Degrave, who had the idea many years ago of looking at mirror symmetry in dimension one. So in mirror symmetry, which you heard of many lectures here, you map curves, holomorphic curves, complex curves, into an algebraic variety. But you fix the homology class of that the fundamental class is mapped onto, and you count them in some suitable way. And in string theory and in other parts, one especially wants to do this for Calabi-Yau's. So you want to count the curves sitting in the Calabi-Yau. And so a Calabi-Yau in dimension one, mirror symmetry in dimension one, would be that you can't really speak of putting curves inside a curve. There's not room, but you can still map a curve of genus G to a curve which is a Calabi-Yau, but that means that it's a torus, it's genus one, because that's a one-dimensional Calabi-Yau. And now saying that you fix where the fundamental class goes means that you fix the degree. So the degree is some fixed number n. And so you can ask the question, how many coverings are there, let's say topological, because then you can pull back the complex structure. How many coverings are there, appropriately counted? So we have sort of n of, well, I won't give it a name because I'm going to introduce a notation in a second. It'll be confusing now. We want to count how many coverings, and as usual, you count things up to isomorphism, and you count one with the multiplicity, which is one of the number of automorphisms. I don't want to explain it exactly, but this will be certainly a rational number. It'll be a finite sum if you do it right. I'll come in a second. But I want to specify the ramification, and the ramification is this. I assume that it's generic ramification. So that means that any critical, if I have a critical value down here, then there's a unique critical point above it. So at any point, the preimage is either n sheets or it's n minus 1 and exactly 2 cross. Okay, so that's the nature of the ramification. And so we want to count this number, and we want to make a generating function. So let me define fg of q to be the sum over all such, well, I take n from 1 to infinity. Of course, n can't be 1 if the genus is not 1, because you can't have map degree 1. So the first coefficient will be 0. It's this number of coverings with all the things I said, generic branching and counted with 1 over automorphisms. And then again, you make a generating function, q to the degree of the covering. And the prediction of, in particular, Degrave, was that this one was supposed to be a modular form, a quasi-modular form. And in fact, of weight 6g minus 6. And there are two parts. One, you have to find a way to compute it, what those numbers are. You don't want to go to your computer and say, please draw pictures of Riemann surfaces. So you need a combinatorial description. That comes from group theory, and he gave. And then he had also a proof of this, a proof in quotes, using ideas from sort of quantum field theory and path integrals. But it wasn't a proof. And anyway, this is certainly a theorem, and an explicit concrete proof was given in this very short paper by Kaneko and myself, which appeared in the same volume as Degrave's paper where he explains the whole thing. So this was, I don't know, 10 or 12 years ago. So this is the theorem. Let me give you an example just so that you see something concrete. So G equals 1 is, in, actually, this is only if G is at least 2. For G equals 1, there's a slight exception because of, you know, torus is an infinite group of automorphisms by translation, and it somehow messes up the counting. So for instance, F2 explicitly is 10p cubed. It has to be of weight 6 because G is 6, G is 2, and in weight 6 we have only three, a base of three elements, p cubed, pq, and I have no idea why I wrote this way, 5p cubed minus 3pq plus 2r divided by 5,000, it's not 5,000, but it's 51,840.
Up to a constant. The second line has a constant term. The line before it doesn't have a constant term.
I have no idea what you mean. There are
the q to the zero.
Well, the coefficient of q to the zero is equal to the coefficient of q to the one, and they're both equal to zero. So you can start at 0, 1, or 2. Those coefficients are zero.
What you wrote doesn't have constant.
It certainly does. Oh, thank you.
That's all I was trying to say.
Thank you very much. We have somebody in the audience who can subtract 5 minus 3 plus 2. Thank you very much. I thought you were complaining about the first line. It was the second line. It's much better. What's more, you're even righter than you know with what I had. There would have been horrible denominators. But this thing actually is integer coefficients, which wouldn't have been true at all for the other. But that's an accident. In no other genus do you get integers. You always get a bounded denominator. OK, so that's the theorem. And it's the theorem of, well, it's a formal theorem of Carnet-Conti with a formal proof, but it was the discovery of Dekhraf and also of the physicist Rudd. I should have maybe also written. Now comes the amazing general, but let me say the combinatorics. So as I said, there are two steps. So two steps. One, give a formula, a computable formula that you can put on the computer, so to speak, for Fg, and then, which Dekhraf had already done, and the other is then show the quasi-modularity. So let me tell you the first part first, and now I go back to partitions. If you have actually for any finite group, but let's now think of Sn, so this is meant to be a German S, as you all know, irreducible representations of Sn correspond to Young diagrams, and therefore also to, so I remind you that any partition, for instance, the partition 3 plus 1, can be represented pictorially by a Young diagram or Young tableau or whatever it's called, so you have N squares, which are on the upper left-hand corner, the way that I do it, if the lower right-hand quadrant. So that corresponds to unique irreducible representation. And now let me define an invariant nu t of lambda. You could do this where t is any constant class in Sn. You could do it for any finite group. It's proportional to, if you take the pi, if you have any element of the group for any finite group, if you have an irreducible representation and a conjugacy class, you of course have the character and the well-known character table by evaluating, well, by taking the trace of pi of t or pi or whatever the element is, but you have something else, which is the action. You take all elements, so this is really the conjugacy class, but I didn't write. You take all elements in the symmetric group which are in the conjugacy class, of here it's the transposition. So t is the transposition, you interchange two of the two numbers, one and two. The conjugacy class consists of all transpositions of I and j. And you see that that's relevant for our problem because here, if I do monodromy, I number these points. And then when you go around and come back, you've interchanged two for the monodromy of the singularity you went around. So it's reasonable that this plays a role. But now that's why we need t. But for any element of the group, you take, for any conjugacy class of the group, you take the sum and then the sum of the corresponding matrices is a scalar by Schur's lemma because it's an irreducible representation, so it's a number, and so this is an integer. And it's actually, this is a very trivial formula that these two numbers are proportional. You have to multiply, it's true for any group and any conjugacy class. So if I have a finite group, a conjugacy class, an irreducible representation, then chi p of the conjugacy class is equal, well, I'll do it the other way, nu c, the way I'm writing it, of pi, is equal to chi p of psi multiplied by the size of the conjugacy class and divided by chi p of 1, which is the dimension of pi. It's completely trivial. Just take the trace of this element. The trace of a scalar is the scalar multiplied by the dimension of the space, but the trace of a sum is the sum of the trace, so they all have the same trace. You just get the trace multiplied by the size of the conjugacy class. But these are integers, and these are integers, but the ones I want are nu c of p. So the answer is, let me give you a little picture. So if I take n equals 4, then you have the following diagrams. And the value, this is the picture of nu, and then the value of this, this is the lambda, which corresponds to a pi, and then the nu t of lambda will be 6, 2, 0, minus 2, and minus 6. It's easy to see that it'll change sign when you flip the Young diagram, which means the contragredient representation. So now we associate to this now a polynomial, h4 of u, which will in this particular case be u to the 6th plus u squared plus 1 plus u to the minus 2 plus u to the minus 6. So hn of u is just the sum over all partitions of n of u to the power of this funny invariant, nu, what am I calling it, nu t of lambda. Okay? So that's that. And then what you show is the following. If you take hn, now I hope I can do this, you sum over all partitions, which again, you shouldn't really even ever put the n. You just sum right from the beginning. I could have just said you take u to the power nu t of lambda times q to the size of the partition. So if you take this sum, then this is a power series in q, of course, but also in x. And this will exactly correspond, the coefficient of q to the n times x to the k, or x to the k maybe over k factorial, if I remember correctly, will exactly correspond to coverings, n-fold coverings, generically branched, as I said, n-fold coverings of T2 with k branched points downstairs. Now, if I have a Riemann surface of genus G, then and here's a genus, a torus, then you find trivially that because the Euler characteristic downstairs is zero, that in the Riemann-Hurwitz formula, n doesn't play any role, and the k, the number of, so I have k branch points, then k will be independent of n. It'll simply be 2g minus 2. That's because downstairs we have Euler characteristic zero. So I could have used k instead of g, but the point is these coverings may not be connected. And so if that will correspond to that. Now, if you take the log of this, then this will correspond to connected coverings, and so that's the generating function we want. But of course, taking the log won't change the quasi-modularity. So actually, in the proof, one shows that the coefficients of this thing are quasi-modular forms, and then when you take the log, well, they're still quasi-modular forms, the log of the power series has coefficients in the same ring as the original power series. So this is the way that you compute it. So I hope this is clear. So you write down this sum. I wrote down explicitly how to define this nu t and an example for n equals 4, how it looks. You take these polynomials, then you take the log of this power series, and now the coefficient of q to the n, x to the k over k factorial, where k is 2g minus 2, will be exactly the rational number we're talking about. So now comes the theorem of Bloch and Okunkov. So first, let me introduce an abstract ring. This is not quite, also the notations are not theirs, so if you know their paper, you still have to listen, unfortunately, because I've changed every single notation slightly. These qk are related to their pk, but shifted by 1 and divided by factorial. But these are more convenient, and they don't have a q1. You'll see in a moment why they might have felt they didn't need a q1, but it's very, very useful. So let R be the abstract polynomial algebra in infinitely many variables where qk has weight k. So of course, the dimension of this space in a given weight k is simply the number of partitions of k. And there's a nice Fock space representation, but I'm not going to talk about that at all, but it's implicit in what it's explicit in what they did and implicit in what I'll tell. And now this will act on, if I have an F in R and a partition of some number, then I can evaluate F of lambda. So what I'm saying is that there exist specific functions, Q1 of lambda, Q2 of lambda, Q3 of lambda, and it continues, but the board, the margin is too small to contain it. So we have a series of specific functions, and they're very explicit. Q1 of lambda is a function you all know very well. It's the function that assigns to every partition 0. That's why Bloch and Okunkov didn't include Q1, but I wanted my abstract ring. Q2 of lambda is the size of the partition, so the simplest imaginable invariant, except that it doesn't work unless you correct it by subtracting a 24th. And Q3 of lambda is exactly the new T of lambda that I told you. Okay, so Q3 is the function that we needed. And so their generalization will say that, I mean, we knew, I knew, and in fact, it's written in their paper that I suggested that such a formula might be true, but I'd forgotten and was trying to wonder how they could possibly have discovered this thing. But anyway, I knew that there were higher functions, but I saw no way to prove the quasi-modularity. So the statement is going to be that not just if you do this procedure that I just did with, if you multiply this out, then you'll find that in this series, of course, since this is the sum, what was it, e to the u, but I've replaced e by u by e to the x. So this becomes e to the nu t of lambda x. And so the coefficient of lambda to the k is, of course, simply the sum over all partitions of the very special function u t to the n to the k, which will be an even integer later, 2g minus 2, times, sorry, nu t of lambda times q to the lambda. It's essentially that. So the thing we're talking about is this, and so they had the idea, given that nu t is just the third of a list of infinitely many interesting functions, why not take any polynomial in these special functions, which I'll define in a minute, and then their theorem is going to be that you'll always get a modular form, but let me first introduce the notation I want. So I define the q bracket of a function. Let's say that I have any function on the set of all partitions. As I say, I'll always work over Q just because everything, all the examples are rational. So if you have any function, arbitrary, no convergence, then the Q bracket is the Q average. We call it the Q bracket, but maybe Q average is better. And you do what you always do in statistical physics. In statistical physics, you have a large ensemble, you have a lot of states, and you have an observable, which in this case is f, so the states would be partitions, and you have an observable and you want to know the expectation value, say in quantum theory, so what will you get when you evaluate f of lambda? So what you'd like to do is take f of lambda, the sum over all partitions, and divide by the sum of one. But of course that doesn't make sense, both sums are infinite, so what you do in statistical physics is of course you put in a factor. In statistical physics, it would be e to the minus 1, I forget where the k is, I think downstairs, it would be e to the minus 1 over Boltzmann's constant times the temperature, and then you would take, if the state is energy eta, well, then you would weight with that power. So you typically have a constant, q, which sort of depends on temperature, and you weight. So here we'll have a constant q, which is just called q, but you can think of it as, you know, as Q gets bigger and smaller, it's getting hotter and colder. And so this is the definition, and then, of course, downstairs, you do the same. So this is the Q average. But, of course, what it is a Q series. I mean, a power series, there are a lot of Qs, that's a capital Q for rational numbers, it's a power series in Q. So we associate to every function, and it's a formal power series, I don't care about convergence at all. Although, actually, all the ones I write down are convergent for Q less than 1. Because they're in fact going to be modular. Okay, so this is the definition. But now if you remember that this denominator, that's what I started with, if you just sum over all partitions, q to the size of lambda, that's the same as p of n, q n. So that's this eta. So I could also write this thing as I take the sum over all lambda in p. And now I simply take f of lambda, q to the lambda, and now I have to divide by this denominator, but the denominator is the reciprocal of this, so I have to multiply by eta, which is, of course, a modular form. But then eta, remember, was not quite right. There was a q to the 124, so I have to actually weight now with q to the lambda minus 24. And you see that's nice, because that lambda minus 24th is exactly our q2. So the result I was talking about before would be the special case, q3 of lambda to some power, which is 2g minus 2, let's say. Well, pretend you didn't have to take the log, and then q to the power q2 of lambda. Okay, so it's completely in terms of this ring. And so now I can give the theorem of Bloch and Okunkov, which is, I don't know, 2003, if I remember correctly. Anyway, about 10 years old. And it says that this q bracket is a quasi-modular form for every f in this ring, which they call the ring of shifted symmetric polynomials. So that's an absolutely wonderful theorem. But it turns out to also have a wonderfully simple proof. When did I start? When should I stop? And so on. Of course, the remarks about Maxime don't count, right? That's. 20 minutes. Sorry?
20 minutes.
Left or since the beginning? Ay, ay, ay. It's all about positive and negative things. Well, then, no, I really don't want to skip my sketch of the proof because it's really a beautiful proof, very, very, very simple. Let me say briefly with these Q3 of lambda r. So you start with the partition. Let's take a very simple example. And you are going to, let me say how I define QK of lambda. QK of lambda, well, you take what are called Frobenius coordinates. So you take the longest diagonal in this Young diagram. So in more complicated, it's the, as far as you can go down the diagonal, it's the Hirsch index. If you think of this as a researcher who has one article with three citations, Maxime is more, but if you have one article with three citations and two with one citation, that's all that you ever wrote, then absolute value of lambda is the number of citations, and the Hirsch index is, you know, the smallest I for which your I-th paper is I citations in the literature, that would be this diagonal. So in general, if I had a more complicated thing, you know, then you would have this diagonal. And so that divides up the Young diagram into this piece, and then the pieces below. So you'd have lengths here, which would be 7/2, 1/2, and then you would also have -1/2, in this case, and -5/2. So you would associate to C a finite set of, this will be contained, and I'll call it F, for fermions, which is Z plus shifted by 1/2, okay? And then this finite set, well, it'll have equally many, it'll be a balanced fermionic set. So it's balanced in the sense that it's a finite subset, and it's equally many positive and negative things, because that's the length of this diagonal. And of course, the sum, so if C lambda, if I take the sum of the absolute value of C in the C lambda, then that's obviously the total area of these Young diagrams, so that's the size of our partition. But now the QK is the sum of, now this is shift, and I think it's Q to the K minus 1. That's right, so I have to take C to the K minus 1, but I have to put a sign, sine of C times C to the K minus 1. So you see, if K is 2, then sine of C times C is just the absolute value of C, so I get this. But then you have to divide by K minus 1 factorial, and you have to subtract a constant, which is the coefficient, the kth coefficient of x over 2 over sinh x over 2, or maybe sine. So I've forgotten the sine. So in particular, if k is 2, you see this is 1. This is sine of C times C, so it's the absolute value. So you'll get lambda. And the thing you have to add is minus a 24th. And so that's the official definition of QK of lambda. Okay. So that's now I've defined to you, so at least you now know the statement of the theorem because that's a complete definition. But of course, it looks very artificial, and there's a much nicer way of doing it, which is also in their paper. This one doesn't work. This one works. The way that you do it is you're going to associate to lambda the set X lambda, which will be simply you take the elements of your partition and you shift them all down. That's why it's called shifted symmetric. You shift the jth entry down by j minus 1/2. Okay? And so this is going to be in a set that I'll call X fermionic 0, which is a subset of X fermionic. So these are sets in the fermions, finite sets, sorry, not elements, but finite sets, such that it's bounded above and co-bounded below. So if you can think of this like Dirac's sea of electrons, you start with the vacuum where all of the negative states, minus 1/2, minus 3/2, and so on, are all occupied. And then you have a new state, which is not the vacuum state, where some of the positive energy states, so the energy here is 1/2 integer, and some of the positive states are occupied, but only finitely many. And there are some holes on the left-hand part. And balanced would be that it's balanced in the same sense that we just had, that there are as many holes on the left. So for instance, if I make one hole by taking this point and moving it here, so you apply some operator like that, then you'll get a balanced set, and that's XF0, where there are as many positive elements as negative holes. And so, in fact, you can see very easily that xf lambda plus is c lambda plus, and x lambda minus is all negative fermions minus c lambda minus. So that's why, that's a correspondence. So now if you do this, I was lucky, and now I need that dangerous implement. Where is it? Okay, so I'll pull this thing down. So now what I do is I associate to any x, in particular x lambda, I associate to x a formal power series, well, it's actually a half power series, just t to the x. So this will be, so in my example, it would be t to the, now I've covered up the example, also for you, so it would be t to the, where's it gone? It was 7/2, I think, was the biggest, t to the 7/2 plus t to the 1/2 plus now t, but now it's not the things that you see, but remember it was the wholes in this case. So in this particular case, it would be, well, it's the lambda j minus 1/2, and in fact, the next one would be t to the minus 3/2 plus t to the minus 5/2, and so on. So in our example, and you see that after a while, since you have everything, this whole thing will be, it'll have a Laurent part, shifted by t to the 1/2, plus, and then the tail, after a certain point, will be the same as it would be for the vacuum, which is this. So although this is an infinite sum, it becomes a rational function, and so then I can define now capital Wx, let's say z, is w little x of e to the z, and once I put in this rational function, that makes sense, and this will be exactly the sum k from 0 to infinity, qk of lambda, qk of x, but then qk of lambda will be qk of the associated x lambda in the way that I just defined, and then here it's simply z to the k minus 1. You see that the q0 for any set x will always be 1, because there it's always a finite set plus this thing, which in the new language is z over 2, over sinh z over 2, and of course that has a simple pole with residue 1. So the 1 over z term will always be 1, so for any such bounded set, but q1 of lambda, q1 of x, if you do the calculation, will be the excess of the number of positive occupied things minus negative unoccupied. So q1 of x equals 0, if and only if x is in this set fermionic. So as I said, they didn't use the q1 because on the partitions which correspond to the balanced ones, you don't see it, but it's actually there. Okay, and now I'm going to give you a nice theorem, which, and I'll try to sketch the proof because it's so, once you've set everything up, it's literally one line. And then that theorem very, very easily, like in two or three lines that I might skip, implies the Blocher-Kunckhoff theorem. So that's the next thing I want to show you, but I want to get the formulas right. So I want to first define a derivation from this ring to itself, which is the derivation that sends, since it's a derivation, I only have to say what it does on generators, it sends qk to the previous one, and of course q0, I should say, it's 1, it's not one of the generators, and obviously q1 goes to 0. Okay, so that's the generator, and I also need the classical theta series, which depends on q, which is the sum over all fermions, which remember are just half integers, of minus 1 to the integer part of nu, times e to the power nu z, times q to the power nu squared over 2. So this is the Jacobi theta function. Okay? And it's very, very easy to see. It's well known, I mean, Jacobi found that this is an odd function, that's trivial, and because it's an odd function, it has a power series with odd powers, and so I can pull out the derivative, but that's what Jacobi found by his triple product formula. That's the cube of eta, is the constant, the leading term, and then it'll be 1 plus h2z squared plus h4z to the fourth. It's a power series expansion, and each hk, I could write down a couple, is a quasi-modular form of weight k. That's the only thing I'll actually need about modular forms, is that this is a one-line proof. Maybe since it's one line, I'll write down the line, and then you have it. Well, you have to prove the proof, which is another one line, but the thing that you do in one line is that 4n times n plus 1 times hn, if n is at least 2, is 8 times the derivative of hn minus 2 plus p, remember our p, the special quasi-molded form, times hn minus 2. That's a very, very simple formula to prove. And you start with h0 is 1. And so since I already told you that differentiation raises the weight by 2 and preserves quasi-modularity, these h's are completely explicit quasi-modular forms. So those are my two ingredients, is this derivation and the theta series. And now the theorem is the following, that for all f which are in the subring of Q, which is actually the subring they used, where now I don't include R1, so the subring of, it's a polynomial. So this is the subring of R, where Q1 does not appear. Then you have the following statement, that theta, you see this is a power series, and so you can apply a power series to a derivation and apply it to an element. And that makes sense because since this derivation reduces the degree by 1 on any polynomial, large powers of d will kill it. And so I can evaluate a whole power series. And the claim is that the Q bracket is simply 0. So now if you think what it means, the Q bracket I can divide by 8 of tau cubed and by z if I want, not by z. So this tells me that if f is d of g, where g is in the subring, Q2 and so on, then if I take this expansion, then I'll find that 0 is equal to the Q bracket of f plus h2 times the Q bracket of d squared f plus dot, dot, dot. And so by induction, since this thing is lower weight, I've already shown that it's quasi-modular, H2 is quasi-modular. So by induction, this gives the quasi-modularity. And the only slight problem is that not every f is in the image, but it's very easy to show that every f of positive weight is the sum of d of something in this subring plus something which is divisible by Q1, and for that, the Q bracket is 0. So in one line, once you have this theorem, you find an inductive form that it's completely programmable. You can make a table that you can actually not only prove, but also evaluate the Q brackets, prove the modularity and evaluate the Q brackets as polynomials in P, Q, and R directly. You never have to write out their Q expansions as we did for the first 2 years of our computations. We had huge sums over partitions, and then we could only get 40 terms of the series because there are a lot of partitions when you go beyond 40 or 50. But now it's completely algebraic. So let me sketch the proof of this theorem, and then I want to say a little bit about the Ziegle-Veach part, but I'll just... Okay, so the idea is this. If you have a set X in XF, and you also have a number in F, which remember is a half integer, then I can simply translate X. You just shove it. Let's say this is 3 halves. You translate it by 3 halves. And this will be the set XZ, which is defined exactly the same way as XF was, which has probably disappeared. So these are subsets now of the integers, which are bounded above and co-bounded below. In other words, their complement is bounded below. So you have this rather trivial change. And so now I claim, well, every element x and z, so here you have an x, which is a subset of z, which is bounded above, unbounded below, then it has a shift, the number of positive things. I mean, it turns out that there's a unique nu that you can shift it by. So under this map, actually I want to write it the other way, I think, I can say given any fermionic number, nu, so half integer, and any partition, lambda, then I simply map mu lambda to the set x lambda that we had before, which was one of these things for the fermions, and then you shift it by nu, and that no longer will satisfy the boundedness condition, but given this x, then q1 of x, it's very easy to see, is going to be exactly nu. And therefore, if you give me an x in this set, you evaluate Q1, and that tells you what nu you need, and that tells you which nu to subtract, and then when you subtract it, you get a bounds fermionic set, and you interpret that as a Young diagram. And so you have this very nice bijection, which actually is certainly known and is used in other forms, in particular in connection with the free fermion, free fermionic field. But I don't want to talk about that, and it plays no role. So now, under this correspondence, you have a very simple lemma. So the lemma is simply this. If I have, again, an x in this set of subsets bounded above and co-bounded below of xz, and here I have a pair consisting of a half integer and a partition, then, and if I have any f in the Bloch-Okunkov ring, then if I want to evaluate f of x, it's very easy. I take e to the power, this nu, this half integer, times my derivation, and apply it to f. That, remember, was a well-defined thing, and then I, well, it's that for lambda, but that means on x lambda. Well, sorry, the way I've done it, just on lambda. Okay, let me prove this, because it's really completely stupid. Since x is equal to nu plus x lambda, that means that w, small w x of t, which remember was the sum over all x in my set bounded above and co-bounded below of t to the x, well, you've just shifted. So this is obviously just t to the w times the corresponding thing for the partition. That's completely obvious. So that means that when I go to the capital W, which was the generating function, remember qk of lambda's qk in this case of x, z to the k minus 1, this was the same thing where you change t to e to the z, well, then this will be e to the nu z times w, well, times the same thing, qk of lambda, z to the k minus 1. So now if you compare, then you see that qk of lambda, qk of x, will be qk of the partition, I won't write the lambda, plus nu times qk minus 1, plus nu squared over 2 times qk minus 2, and so on. But then remember our derivation, d sends qk to qk minus 1, qk minus 1 to qk minus 2. So this is, that's this. In the case of qk, but then if you have a derivation, then the exponential of it is an automorphism, and the qk are ring generators. So you get this formula for free, and in particular, you have two special cases that already, well, one of them I already mentioned, q1 of x is the nu, and q2 of x is the q2 of the partition, which remember is the size of the partition minus the 24th. There's no contribution from q1 because it's zero for partitions, but then there's a contribution from q0, so nu squared over 2. So you have these two formulas. And now let me prove the theorem, which is above. So now, proof of the theorem. So I'm going to write, I want to take the q bracket of e of theta of this derivation applied to f. F, remember, was in the subring not involving q1. I want the q bracket of that, and I might as well divide it by eta of tau, because I want to show it's zero, so it's equally zero if I divide by eta of tau. So by what I've already told you, that's the sum of all over all partitions of q to the power, the size of the lambda minus the partition. But now I have to insert theta of delta, right? So therefore, I have to put here theta of delta, which by the definition of the theta series, which is still there, is the sum. So this is all partitions, this is all fermionic numbers, half integers, I have minus 1 to the integer part of nu times e to the nu times the derivation, because I'm involving my thing here. That's the next term. Then I have e to the nu squared over q to the nu squared over 2, so that comes here. Okay? And then I have to take this and apply it to f at lambda. Right? That's the recipe. That's what the left-hand side is. But now, by the lemma, the lemma said that there was a bijection between pairs consisting of a partition and a half-integer shift. And under this lemma, well, this thing is just q2 of x, because that was the second formula written here, the size of lambda minus the 24th plus nu squared over 2. Similarly, e to the nu delta f of lambda, well, that's just f of x, f of x. And finally, minus 1 to the integer part of lambda is minus 1 to the power integer part of q1 of x, because q1 of x is lambda. So now I've written in terms of lambda, and I promised you a one-line proof, and I'm almost at the end of the line, but it's still going to work. This is zero. And the reason that that's zero is completely obvious. You have an involution. An involution, which is really stupid. You map x to x star, which is the stupidest thing you can think of. If your set, which is now a subset of Z, if it contains zero, you take zero out. And if it doesn't contain zero, you put zero in. That's a pretty silly involution. But if you think of this involution, then our W X of T, which was the sum T to the X, well, you just add or subtract it. So when you do this, you're going to simply add or subtract one. And so if you remember that the coefficient of z to the k minus 1, and this is qk, says qk of x star will be equal to qk of x for all k different from 1. But q1 of x star will differ from Q1 of x by plus or minus 1. Well, it'll differ by 1 in one direction or the other. So if you just apply the involution, this sum is 0 because the terms just cancel in pairs. Every time you have x and you go to x star, f of x only involves q2, q3. But those things don't change. So this is invariant. q2 is also at least q2, so it's also invariant. But this q1 goes up by 1, so minus 1 to the integer part of q1 goes up by half. Sorry, change the sign, and so everything cancels in pairs. So you now get the simple one-line proof of a theorem that immediately applies Bloch-Okunkov. Now, my time is, I hope, still positive?
Very small.
Can I apply a scaling of a minute? Okay. I wanted to talk briefly about the Siegel-Veitch constant thing, so maybe I'll just say then in words how it works. That's what started this whole thing, and it's a very, very complicated investigation with Müller. It's been going on for 3 years using this Bloch-Okunkov theorem. So basically, the numbers that I'm not going to then repeat the formulas. We had them all in this lecture. I spent till 3 in the morning last night with my colleague on the phone. Well, that was only half an hour, but then myself preparing that I would be able to explain it correctly, and I won't need to. But we had a formula from the paper of, well, Maxime and collaborators. I'll remind you, it was a formula that said that if you're looking at the stratum 1, 1, 1, 1 of flat surfaces, sorry, any M1 up to Mn, the stratum of flat surfaces, so a Riemann surface with a differential form with zeros of order M1 up to Mn, then there's a Lyapunov story, and the sum of these positive Lyapunov exponents, Maxime had somehow, I think it was mostly him or all him, I'm not at all in this field, had seen that this has everything to do with intersection numbers in moduli spaces. That's one of the things that goes in. But here there's an explicit formula, which, if I remember correctly, is like this. And then plus, well, there was a factor pi squared over 3, but I want to renormalize it. So the thing called C area of the, well, of the particular surface you're looking at, and C area is the thing that Anton explained in his talk. When you have these cylinders, then you take, you count them. You count the number of geodesics up to a certain length, but you count them according to the weighting them by the area of the cylinder, which would say stays. So the original Siegel-Veitch constant, well, it was Veitch. You didn't put in that area factor, but it turns out this had much better properties. And then you do something with the asymptotics of that. But the final upshot when you take the average, in some sense, or the generic point of the stratum, is that you have a relation between one thing you want, this number, which is very simple, and for the principal stratum, which is the only one. Well, no, we have results in principle for all strata, but we've worked out in great detail. For 1, 1, 1, this is just a simple number. And this is another number you want. And because of the relation with moduli spaces, these things are related to the volumes of moduli spaces or various strata in the space of flat surfaces. So they can be expressed. That was done, well, in particular by the work of Chen and Müller. You can express that all in these Bloch-Okunkov terms and therefore show that the generating functions of various counting functions like this, so you have to go to Hurwitz space and look at the ramification like I did in the special case of coverings of a torus by, well, it's still coverings of a torus but with more generic ramification. You can translate the problem of evaluating these numbers into a problem of counting, of averaging functions over partitions of these Q brackets, which we know are Q modular. And in particular, these numbers like C area, which the prediction was that they're always rational because they're supposed to be intersections in some moduli space. And in many cases, it was known. I mean, that's Eskin, Maser, and Zorich, and so on. There are formulas. But it's very, very hard to get your hands on either the volumes or the areas or they also, Chen and Müller found that you should also do other counts. So here we're counting the cylinders by the width times the height of the cylinder, because it's the area. But it turns out it's also a good idea to put powers. I forget exactly the formula, so they're weighted things. So they make higher Siegel-Veitch constants, Cp, which are also interesting. And C minus 1 would be the C area. But the others are perfectly good invariants also. And it turns out that the C area are exactly given by the limiting behavior as tau tends to 0 of the quasi-modular form associated to a very particular element of the Bloch-Okunkov ring. And so you can answer all of these questions completely if you can calculate some rather difficult generating functions in this Bloch-Okunkov thing and really calculate these things. So we have many, many results on that, and I was going to say something about them, but maybe it's just hopeless. Maybe I'll just mention one thing, because that's at least still on the level of partitions, so purely combinatorial. So what Chen and Müller found is that to compute this CP for any p, including p equals minus 1, so the area case, but also these weighted, here you have to normalize the whole area of the surface to be 1, what they found is that those CP correspond in some way to TP and then Q3. So I already told you for the generic ramification, if you have a bunch of ramification points, k of them, but they're all generic, then that corresponds to the Q3. But now, if you multiply this thing k times, but actually you have to take the so-called cumulants, it's an alternating sum by inclusion exclusion, then this thing corresponds to CP. And TP is a function of, so this is the Q average. So remember, the Q average is defined for every function. It's only quasi-multilar when you're in this special ring, but it's defined. So they found that the CPs were in terms of TP, and TP is defined as follows. It's 1 over n factorial, lambda is a partition of n, but then it's a huge sum over all the other partitions of n of the size of the constant class times the square of the character times sp, where sp of a thing is very simple, it's just the moment. So the sum lambda j to the p. So you have to take this kind of transform using the character table of the original thing into this. I think the form is right, but maybe the 2 is wrong. But then so he asked me, so this is, you know, lambda 1 to the p up to the last 1 to the p. And then they did a lot of calculations. You get completely weird numbers, and they asked me to see if I could recognize them. And so you start, if you do a computer calculation, the first thing you'd find is that when you do this n, then t, they especially want t minus 1. T minus 1 of n is a very beautiful number. It's the nth partial sum of zeta of 2. And so that generalized that TP of lambda, so this is a theorem that I found on the computer and Müller then proved. It's not that hard to prove. It was somehow, it took a while for us to understand that that was the statement, that TP is just the sum over all elements of the Young diagram of the hook length of S to the power P minus 1. So the hook length of a thing is what you would think. You have a thing and you go as far as you can to the top and the bottom, and you add that up, that's called the hook, and the number of squares is the hook length. So for this very simple diagram, the hook lengths are 1, 2, 3, up to n, and so if p is minus 1, if p is minus 1, then you get the sum 1 over n squared. So this is a non-trivial thing, but then it turned out that t, so another theorem, less obvious, although also not very deep, is that if p is greater than or equal to 1, so not minus 1 and odd, then these tps belong to the Bloch-Okunkov ring. They are polynomials. So this TP is just a function. You can evaluate it for any real number, p, but if p is a positive, strictly positive odd number, then that function is a shifted symmetric polynomial, and therefore it's a bracket, and what's more, it's bracket when you multiply by any, by anything in the ring, is a quasi-multiple form. So if f is in the ring and p is positive and odd, then by Bloch-Okunkov plus this fact, dp times f, q will be in the ring of quasi-modular forms. And then what we found with a huge amount of computer calculation by looking at hundreds of examples into a very, very complicated formula, we still haven't completely proved, although we've proved many cases, that this is the sum of certain differential operators, rho ij, which are very common. Well, the first, if I or j is less than 5, we got explicit formulas by the computer, and then we finally guessed the general thing. You have certain differential operators on the ring F, and then you apply those universal operators, and here you take the ith derivative of the Eisenstein series, well, essentially the E before renormalized, of weight J plus P plus 1. So this is still conjectural, but we've proved in very, very many cases, and the form of this is such that if it's true for positive p, it's also true for p equals minus 1 with a very small modification, and using that you get formulas, exact formulas, for the volumes of all of these strata and asymptotic formulas, and also for the area thing, so for the Siegel-Veitch counting. But some of the results are now unconditional, but the most general, in particular for the area counting, is still conditional on proving this thing, which we've only proved for, you know, a lot of special cases, but not in general. So there's this very, very interesting algebraic and combinatorial structure on this ring with these TPs, and that, you know, very amazingly, even though they're defined, well, in two different ways, completely differently, but they turn out to be polynomials in the QK and therefore to act on the ring. And so there's a very rich algebraic and combinatorial structure. So As said in the introduction, I'm somebody who likes formulas with no content. And to twist a quote that we heard from Maxime when he was a young man, I'm a specialist in special problems. Okay, so thank you, and thank you, Maxime.
The great talk which you presented with exponentially increasing speed.
So, question. Just one remark, we're going to interrupt you. The fact that some of the components is rational, it's not obvious at all. This part of algebraic geometry, but part is some kind of different measure, and we can't have a proof that it's a priori that it's rational.
No, but when you take the average or something, no, I mean, no, for the generic. I said that it's not, but because. But that you have an expectation that it's connected because of multiply spaces. But here, well, this is certainly rational. Nobody can take that away from me. In fact, it's n over 8 in our case. And this thing is rational because we have a formula for it. Well, that was already done by Esken, Maser, and Zorich. But I was going to write down the generating function we find for the volumes. I'll just say it in words. Take the Hurwitz zeta function at 3/2, but shift it by half. So you take even at 1/2. So you take 1 over the square root of n, well, it's slightly divergent, summed over n is 1/2, 3/2, 5/2. Sorry, shifted. So 1 over the square root of x plus square root of x plus 1/2, x plus 3/2, x plus 5/2. Expand that as a power series in x. It has an asymptotic expansion. It starts square root of x. So call that y. So y is a power series starting with square root of x. And now you invert that. Then x is a Laurent series starting y squared. And the coefficients of that inverse power series of the shifted Hurwitz zeta function are essentially the volume of the corresponding strata. That's the formula. And for that, you can get asymptotic formulas, not that easily, but we can. I was going to write them down, but I ran out of time.
Behind the schedule, so I suggest to ask further questions during the break, and we'll resume at 12:05. Thanks again.
Thank you.